No stranger to innovation, the Olin College of Engineering in Massachusetts was founded 10 years ago to embrace a new model for engineering education. The college aims to create the next generation of innovators and leaders, not just calculating machines. Olin students dive into their projects from day one rather than starting with abstract theory. Our next group literally sailed to the front of the class with their project. Let's welcome Dr. Dave Barrett, Dr. Drew Bennett, and their two recent graduates, Jamie McCandless and Jason Curtis.
Good morning.
Good morning. Dr. Barrett, it's been 3 years. You were our keynote speaker 3 years ago. Welcome back. So could you tell us a little bit about what's been going on at Olin?
Well, Olin has a very unique curriculum, and one of the best ways to really understand it is to compare it to a traditional engineering education, the one that Ray got and I got and most of the people in the audience. In a traditional education, our students are taught stuff largely out of context of any real-world application, and it's quite literally the case of, here's calculus, trust us, someday it'll be useful. This happened to most of you. Students sit in that class and they go, but I'm an engineer, I want to build things, why am I learning calculus? And the whole system really doesn't really work well. At Olin, we've inverted that system, put it entirely on its head, and we spend 4 years doing real-world, in-context, team-based projects. We start in the freshman year doing small, simple projects, and we do projects for 4 years, and by the time they're seniors, they're doing real-world projects with real-world timelines and budgets for a whole host of industrial and professional customers.
Wow, that's great. Now, Dr. Bennett, I know you run the senior project. Can you talk about that program?
That's right. The SCOPE program is our senior capstone engineering project, and we do real-world problems for companies that have something that needs to be solved, but perhaps they don't have the time or the resources to do it right away themselves, so they bring it to us. Since 2005, we've worked with over 50 companies on over dozens of projects, ranging from medical device and instrument design for Boston Scientific to automating a crop sprayer for AGCO, great big monster. The things that attract the companies and the students to the SCOPE program are, number one, the teams function as real professional engineering teams. They report directly to the sponsor. They learn to do everything from detailed technical design and analysis to budgeting, scheduling, and even a business case analysis, if that makes sense for the project. All projects, as I said before, are real-world problems, no toy problems for us. This is something that has a life well beyond SCOPE. That's what we like about it. And number three, at the end of the program, we hand all the IP back to the sponsor to encourage them to take that project out to industry and out to the market as quickly as possible. And finally, of course, the sponsors are thrilled to get the opportunity to tap into the energy and the creativity of our seniors.
Wow, that's great. So Jason and Jamie and I would like to make a very special announcement here on the stage in day three of the keynote that their project this year took on a very nautical direction.
Well, actually, Ray, our SCOPE project was actually working with AGCO to move them towards a fully autonomous agricultural sprayer, and we did so by helping provide a proof of concept for autonomously reloading that sprayer's big fluid reservoir.
The nautical project we took on was actually completely student-initiated and run. We decided to develop a fully autonomous sailboat for the International Robotic Sailing Competition. We chose the project because it was hard. We had to replace the boat's human captain with a robot control system capable of navigating an obstacle course in the water using only power available from the wind.
This is exactly the kind of project that students at our school love to sink their teeth into. So when we kicked off the project just under a year ago, a full 10% of our school signed up. That was 30 students. So it's easy to rack up percentage points when you only have 300 undergraduates. But we had 30 students, 20 of them were first years, and only a handful of us had any sailing experience whatsoever, and we were setting out to, in under a year, build a world-class robotic sailor.
We call that jumping into the deep end. Since we had so far to go, from almost no sail racing experience to a competition-ready boat, we based our strategy around parallelizing sub-team work as much as possible, effective testing, and rapid iteration. As Drew, our mentor, often advises us, first make it work, then make it work reliably, and only lastly, make it work better.
So we could do those three things as quickly as possible. We divided into three separate teams to start with. The mechanical team's job was to build a boat that could perform in the competition. That's no mean feat when, to start with, you don't know the difference between a gaff rig sloop and a starboard tack. The electrical team's job was to outfit this boat with a hardware package that would collect the necessary sensor data, actuate the actuators, among other things. The code team's job was to create a code architecture that would allow the boat to perform all the tasks required in the competition autonomously.
The standard robotic architecture involves code onboard the robot that uses sensors and actuators to interact with the universe. Sensor data comes in from the environment. A central intelligence processes or thinks about the data and makes the decision on how to act. This is actually a bit of a simplification of our architecture. In our system, thanks to Dave's mentoring, the sense-think-act paradigm is realized on multiple levels, mimicking the functionality of a human brain.
So this is the robotic software which runs actually on the boat. For our purposes, we wanted to have highly effective testing, so we wanted operators to be able to interact with the boat without having to have physical access to the computer on board. So we made a separate program called the Operator Control Unit, or OCU, which communicates back and forth with the robot using LabVIEW's network streams. On the OCU, the operator can send missions down to the robot, they can view the status, tell what the robot is thinking, and they can tweak parameters on the fly. What you see here is a screenshot of a simulated mission with our boat running a mission on Lake Wobbin. You can see we have all sorts of data, a wealth of goodies for our programmers to interact with the boat while the boat is on the water. This gave us a huge advantage over our competitors who had to deal with rudimentary and non-existent GUIs, where most of the changes that we would want to make to tune things were just a few clicks away. Other boats had to be taken physically out of the water, disassembled, and their chips had to be reflashed just to make the same changes that we could make in a few clicks. We've been there too, and it's not a fun way to test.
We've also been on robotics projects that flowed serially. First mechanical, then electrical, and code. Many of them failed painfully because the code team couldn't even begin testing until the other teams finished. Aware of this challenge, we focused on having our sub-teams work in parallel as much as possible. A good example of this is that we kicked off our project by building a minimal coding test platform using an off-the-shelf remote-controlled sailboat to stand in for the final boat. This way, the code team could begin validating their code long before the competition boat was ready to get wet. It was our first boat on the water, so naturally, the code team named it Zero.
Since we couldn't bring Boston Harbor or Lady Bird Lake or any other body of water large enough to show you black body radiation, our competition boat, in action, we brought Zero and a kiddie pool. And there's something missing. Ah, wind. That's it. So what we've told...
mate.
So what we've told Zero to do here is we've given it a simple mission, which is to approach a waypoint constantly, a waypoint that's near the center of the pool. And at any point in time, Zero is setting her sail and her rudder to approach that point best. There are a few differences here between, as you can see, the control architecture here is built for larger areas of water, but she generally does pretty well in a tiny pool like this as well.
Could have something to do with the ton of Wi-Fi going on in this room right now.
Yeah, let's blame it on them. So there's some differences between Zero and our competition boat here, Black Body Radiation. Whereas Black Body Radiation has a sensor package on board, Zero is using nothing but an overhead camera and LabVIEW's pattern matching software to track the location of the boat in the pool and spoof the sensor data that the boat would see if it had a sensor package on board. All of the computation for Zero is happening offboard on a desktop computer, but we're running the same program, the same logic, exactly the same VI, in fact, that would run embedded on Blackbody Radiation's single board Rio. Here's a shout out to LabVIEW for being natively cross-platform.
This coding test platform helped us immensely in allowing our code team to test before the other teams were ready. Thanks to Zero, the very first time our competition boat set sail, she was able to navigate autonomously. So while the code team was busy testing and validating our code, the electrical team was developing a robust hardware package. The mechanical team was designing and fabricating a sailboat completely from scratch. When everything finally came together, with plenty of time left over for integrated system testing, we had a fully autonomous sailboat. So let's go ahead and take a look at some footage of black body radiation in action sailing in Lake Waban and Boston Harbor. We're happy to announce that even though we were a first-year team at the competition, we managed to tie for first place in the navigation challenge and came in second overall. The other more experienced teams were actually so impressed with us that they invited us to host the 2013 competition.
Wow, that's really impressive. So what's up for next year?
So unfortunately, Jamie and I have graduated, so we can't continue on the project, but we've left it in the capable hands of our dedicated team of youngins.
And they've already made plans to outdo this year's results. They're even considering sailing across the Atlantic. So stay tuned to see what happens.
All right, thank you. Thank you so much. That's really impressive. Thank you.